Hello everybody, in this video we are gonna prove the fundamental theorem of algebra. So let's get started. Guys, I am having a giveaway on this channel. I am giving away two Oxford dictionaries. See the description box for the rules. And yeah, please subscribe to make sure your math teacher never gets mad at you. Alright, so the fundamental theorem of algebra states that if we have a non-constant complex polynomial, what is a complex polynomial? Well, complex polynomial means a polynomial with complex coefficients like this one in the example. So if we have a complex polynomial or P of z, where z is a complex number, then the equation where we put the non-constant complex polynomial equals to 0 has at least one root, meaning we get at least one value of z for which the non-constant polynomial gets 0. But this statement is true only for complex numbers and not for real ones. You may ask why? So my friend, the answer will be provided in the last slide. So stay tuned for that and let's move on with the proof. So to start the proof, let's suppose a complex polynomial P of z and also a contradiction that this polynomial is not zero for any complex number z. As we suppose that P of z is not zero anywhere in the complex plane, so this implies that 1 by P of z is an entire function. What is an entire function, by the way? A complex function that is analytic at all finite points of the complex plane. And what is analytic? So a complex function that is complex differentiable in a certain region is called analytic in that particular region. So we have mod of f of z equals to 1 by mod of p of z. We took mod here because we will apply the definition of a continuous function on it later. Now we are taking mod of z to the raised to the power n common from each term of mod of f of z. Now this clearly shows that if mod of z approaches to infinity, mod of f of z approaches 0. Which in turn implies that for every c, c is any point in the domain of f of z, for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0 such that distance between z and c is always less than delta, which implies distance between f of z and f of c will always remain less than epsilon. And this quality makes our function a continuous function, which will help us move further in the proof. Now we know that f of z is a continuous function, but look what boundedness theorem says. If a function is continuous on an interval, then it must be bounded on that certain interval. So we can say that f must be bounded for all finite complex numbers. Considering that f is bounded and an entire function, we can use another theorem, that is Liouville's theorem. Sorry for my pronunciation, it's a hard name. Which states that the only bounded entire functions are constants. Wait a minute, our function f of z is not constant and also entire and bounded. So we have to admit that our little assumption that P of z is not zero for any complex number is false. And our function definitely has at least one complex root. Ding ding ding! So, ladies and gentlemen, the time has come for our mind-boggling question to be answered. The question was why this theorem is true for complex numbers only and not for real ones. So, we have two examples of polynomials to examine this behavior. In the first example, you can see x squared plus 1 is a real non-constant polynomial and it has no real roots. The only roots it has are complex. But in the second example of a similar complex polynomial, x squared plus iota, we can see that we have two complex roots of this polynomial. So you can find real polynomials with no real roots, but you cannot find any complex polynomial that is non-constant and has no roots. All right, buddies. That's it for the proof. I hope you learned something from it. Please share this video and subscribe to my channel and also ring the bell to get notified every time I upload. And I will see you all in my next video. Bye!